Yeah, what's your title now, James? I forget. 50 years later, I now need to put on marble cakers. So let me just get all of that out of the way and just say good afternoon to everybody. After 3 decades, to stand here reunited with the Jet family, I've never really got. But thank you for inviting me to help you to reflect, re-challenge, and to reboot. Let me start off by saying a very happy birthday to Jet. Thank you for your solid presence in the life of our country for 3 decades. And while I'm onto it, let me also congratulate everyone in the room who over the decades have not just supported Jet, but in your own tireless work in education over many decades, quite a lot of you from the days of our struggle and through some challenging and very vexatious moments in our new democracy. In addition to Jet and other agencies, I do perhaps want to do the high-risk thing instead of the 30 years of chances. I want to single out 2 civil society groupings. Firstly, I want to single out Equal Education, one of the few community-based organizations, to say thank you for creating such a strong platform for communities to be activists, fighting for their rights, enshrined in our constitution, and for shaping learning environments and encouraging participants in that environment to not just be hapless victims. The second grouping, a civil society grouping I want to single out, is Section 27, for their consistent campaigning and legal challenges to bring to life some of the, and to enforce the promises of our constitution and our Bill of Rights. Thank you. I also want to do something which sometimes people are a bit conflicted about, but I want to thank our minister, my comrade Angie Motshekga, for her consistent leadership and education over the years. She was a leader in the National Education Crisis Committee. She has been steadfast and present in the education sector, not only in her ministerial role. And I want to say that she, for us to remember, she's one of very few ministers who has consistently not weaponized poor people for cheap political gain. I believe that she's one minister who really cares. Thank you, Minister. But I do want to urge our minister to work better with and to listen better to the people in this room and, in fact, to civil society organizations on whom we now rely to enforce the constitutional rights of our learners, sometimes to the chagrin of our minister. Minister, I ask you, please see the people in this room as key resources and reference points. Now let me get back to Jet. The story of Jet is a wonderful story of leaders from across society who dared to dream of a country where we could have very different educational outcomes. And looking at the huge challenges we are facing in education today, some of us may well call it a mess. And yes, there are some totally unacceptable manifestations and systemic sores that are being tolerated and fueled that we should in fact be ashamed of. I hope that it has us all hopping mad enough to hopefully apply ourselves with the same vigor that we set off on the journey of the early 90s when we founded Jet. And hopefully we will increase our intolerance now of what exists today, because we are 30 years down the tracks and we should have the right to expect better. Let us allow ourselves the luxury of reflection, to acknowledge success, and to embolden ourselves for the next phase. We started by saying, I get really furious with people who state that things are worse than under apartheid. I urge those people to watch what my family re-watched this week. A documentary called Action Commandant. The life of Ashley Krill, the student leader who became in Konto a Sizwe combatant. He was shot and killed with a boot to his neck in front of a former teacher. I dare anyone who holds those beliefs of doom to show me where in this country young people in their early teens are shot and killed because they demand change in their schools and in their country. I challenge those who hold those beliefs to show me where in our country today the government does and can get away with banning the media from covering the truth. To deny the meaningful progress is an insult to all of us who fought bravely and the many who gave their lives for the hard-won freedoms that we sometimes take for granted today. Similarly, I wish to remind us in this room of the vision and the courage displayed when we were given the opportunity to write our own history. JET is one great example of what we did with that opportunity. We were in the middle of a time where there was deep conflict and division, and we were a country on the verge of total collapse. For those who were not there at the time, it may be hard to imagine the levels of violence and trauma that prevailed and the courage of leaders of all constituencies to start to see that we were in an intractable situation of deadlock and conflict, where we could fight one another to the bitter end, and where we could land up with the country in complete ashes. Or we could try to reach out and to negotiate a different future. There are many learnings from that time, including things we could have done way better. But I have yet to hear a coherent alternative pathway we could have followed sustainably that would have still stood up, warts and all, 30 years later. We had learned then many lessons from the pathways of our neighbors in Angola, Mozambique, and later Zimbabwe. I'm sure others will have the benefit of hindsight about our journey too. Key to our journey was what the formation of JET was a microcosm of. There we were, sworn enemies, be it as bourgeois capitalists, diehard socialists, communists, Democrats, or whatevs, as young people would say. Or we were sitting there as sworn political foes. We were all positioning ourselves to claim the biggest stake in the hearts and the minds of voters in the first democratic elections. But this is the mark of leadership. What prevailed in the end was a remarkable ability to see ourselves as people who had a common need to build a different country where we have two main drives. Firstly, to place our children first and to give them a better chance in life through appropriate, decent education that will enable them to live dignified lives through livelihoods and skills that will enable them to be meaningful contributors to the welfare of their families, and that will ensure that the next generations will be imbued with curiosity and the confidence to create, to dream, and to challenge the advancement of our country. Secondly, we knew we had to ensure that our education system will provide the right education and skills to make us globally competitive and prosperous as a nation. So we set totally suspicious of one another. 14 founding business partners, 4 major political formations, 3 trade union formations, the National Education Crisis Committee that was at that stage recognized as the umbrella organization of organizations in the education sector that were active in the struggle for freedom. And together with key representatives of black businesses, who themselves were severely constrained and oppressed by apartheid legislation, and they were held back by the same repressive laws to anyone that applied to anyone who questioned the apartheid system. The leadership of all these constituencies signed up because they had the vision, they had the courage to establish a new partnership that had been unimaginable the year before we started. They were bold and decided that we needed something substantial. They were also courageous enough to recognize the strengths each constituent part brought to that table. Those from the liberation movement brought a vision that had evolved over the centuries of struggle. And in fact, it was a compelling vision that had grown and evolved organically as the struggle evolved. And I remember, for example, in 1976, our demand was for equal education. By 1990, 4 years later, we realized that actually the education that white children were getting was just not good enough. And that that education too was seeking to subjugate and was not preparing young people to be confident global citizens. So the call changed from equal education to people's education for people's power. A shift that was very profound and which laid the basis for what we demand of our education system today. And through the NECC, this vision of the education charter was brought into JET. The business partners mobilized funding, and equally importantly, insights into the skills needed to build successful businesses and a competitive economy. And actually, I too want to pay tribute to that giant, Mike Rochelt, who peacefully passed on in 2018. Mike had this vision, and he sought out and decided that Tata Madiba was his man, his partner in crime on this road. And Tata then joined Mike in this quest to convince the key role players to come together in the partnership that became JET. May their brave souls rest in peace. They're probably turning in their grave at some of what goes on in our country today and in education. Moving on, it's a happy day. The big corporate partners under the leadership of Mike raised 500 million. JET used these funds to leverage a further 680 million. And these funds were disbursed over 10 years, achieving tangible, outstanding results. And I want to pay tribute, Nick, to you and the team, Shabani Mangani, for constantly and boldly reviewing where our country was at, what the needs were, and defining what the most meaningful contribution was that JET could make. And in this process, they were offered difficult choices to be made, to bring us from that journey to where we started, to where JET is today, alive and kicking at the age of 30. It requires a lot of courage to make changes that are outside of your comfort zone. Many credible organizations have seen their demise. They don't exist any longer, because they were not bold enough to move with the times. JET did, and JET still does. That is why we can come together after 30 years of phenomenal changes and celebrate the fact that JET is still. Okay, if any of you are really bored, please exit now to the sideshow, okay? We love it, we learn. So for all of us gathered here in celebration of JET, the new JET, which is still contributing meaningfully to educational outcomes in our country, and increasingly more and more so in SADC and in our continent. For all of us gathered here, it was necessary to reflect on that distinguished past and to take courage from that and to learn from that so we can all support JET in its constant reinvention and realignment that is necessary for the next 30 years. And Ashley, Mr. Chair, you looked as if you were doubtful whether you were going to be around. But all I can tell you, I have every intention to live for a very long time, if nothing else, out of sheer malice to those tzotzis who think they can hijack our country. So I intend to be around, so I assume JET will be around. But I also want to assert that none of us understood the full complexity of how to manage a painful transition from inequality, deep poverty, and conflict towards a prosperous and harmonious future. And in other sectors, it's a bit easier, but I firmly believe that education is a highly contested terrain because it's not only about skills. It is also at the very center of transmitting the values that produces and sustains the values and social relations that are necessary to produce the society we wish for. And today the challenge remains, how do we move from that unacceptable, difficult past to a more equitable, modern, empathetic country? Because we haven't arrived there, we're far from it. And since inception, JET identified a few key building blocks. JET identified that teachers are at the heart of our education system. Their training must equip them to develop appropriately skilled citizens who are confident and curious to learn more. And it's critical to offer ongoing development and training to teachers in the system to enable them to keep abreast of the needs of a modern, globally competitive nation. Secondly, JET identified the importance of ECD for all, but especially for children from backgrounds of extreme poverty. Thirdly, the need for adult basic education. Fourthly, vocational and further education. And lastly, creating pathways in and through the education system for young people. And it's been amazing how JET has constantly renewed itself to play the best possible role in an evolving democracy as our country and the various government and non-government civil society evolve, and as new civil society players evolve, and its hand in the establishment of the NECT, as our chair said earlier. Through this, JET has remained nimble-footed and adapted itself to fit in one of these phases. So JET has now evolved into JET Education Services, an organization that is self-funded on the basis of providing world-class services. James and the team, I do perhaps want to sound a word of caution about this. Please be vigilant and do not let demand only shape your offerings. Please retain your courage to remain visionary, to always be alert to what our country needs. And please never lose your courage to innovate and reinvent yourselves. Nimble-footed partners are what key role players and stakeholders need. It's ever necessary for JET to retain its ability to lead all the role players to see beyond their own little patches. And that's why I don't want you to just chase what the demand is for. Today we find ourselves at another crossroads in our country, and there will be many more. Some may feel afraid, tired, or even hopping mad. All of the above are relevant. I would like for us to be careful what we wish for. We wanted freedom, didn't we? Now we have it. We have many learnings, many scars on our backs, since democracy even. But most of all, we have actually taken our country forward. Our country is a different place. Maybe not the place we had entirely hoped for, but we cannot dispute that we now have in our hands the tools to create and to shape. Freedom is now in our hands. And we will stumble along the way because we're human. Well, a few days ago, Minister Mocheha announced very important and very necessary expansions, I believe, to the school curriculum. If successfully implemented, these expansions will contribute greatly to rebuilding our capacity for artisanal training, so necessary for the reindustrialization goals we have set for ourselves as a nation. This will also offer young people a range of employment options in sought-after fields that will make them employable and contributors to their families. And some of JET's current work is already right on the money, fit for purpose for supporting these changes. The work with CETUS, for example, the work around in-service support training of teachers, as well as the pre-service teacher education work, must hone in on helping teachers to see these new proposals as exciting opportunities to produce better outcomes for the children in their care. We need to get the entire value chain in education, from learners to parents to teachers to employers and society align behind this, and we need them to have the right plans to make this work, because many plans have just run aground because the thinking wasn't there. We need to assess what partnerships are needed to bring this to life. So James and the team, I want to say JET is so well positioned to play a leading role in bringing this curriculum to life with what you see as your core functions, in ensuring that all key stakeholders are well equipped to take up their place in this journey. It's time to reconsider the nature, what the chair had spoken about, of social compacts. We need to take our country through this curriculum, through and forward this curriculum. It is time to place the future of our children uppermost in our minds again. It is time to reassert that social solidarity is what is needed if we wish to attain social cohesion. Because often people speak emptily about social cohesion and they forget about the fact that social cohesion is only possible if there's social solidarity. Let us look at well-intentioned policies like BEE and the instruments created, but abused shamelessly, like social and labor plans, BEE scorecards. And if these are applied well, there are some powerful opportunities for institutions like JET to reclaim and reshape those in partnership with government. There are good companies out there. There's some bad ones, but there are also good ones out there, many of them in this room even still with JET, who can help to reshape those partnerships. And we need those good companies. We know those good companies desperately need help. JET can do that. It's an offering JET can do. And the new education director that Minister Mochega is now leading provides great opportunities, and we hope the minister too will listen. We are going to need research. We're going to need to monitor this new curriculum. We're going to need to do an evaluation systematically, the bread and butter of what JET Services has become. There's work to be done. We once again, yes, perch on the precipice of further division and increasing poverty. But we once again need vision, courage, and partnership. And we know that we can do it. I leave JET to that challenge. And we want JET to know that us in the room here with you today are right behind you. Thank you very much.
So I'm forcing Cheryl to sit in Ashley's pretty cheese. Okay, so I'm capturing her a little bit. But Cheryl, it's not every day that we have the luxury, the honor, the privilege to have you in our midst. So given your history, your pathway, your significant contribution to this country and its development, what could be your message to the youth today?
That's a big ask. I like to hear from young people what they think about what we can do, what we should do, and in fact what they are doing, because they're doing a lot. I just want to say to young people that this is a wonderful country. The fact that this country is still holding together. Nick was saying to me earlier, but we are in such trouble, and I said to him, no, Nick. I'd in fact asked colleagues to play a little video clip, and I believe we're going to play it after this. Every day in this country, people get up and do what they're supposed to do to the very best of their capabilities. And that's why with all these high-level thuggery, skullduggery, and theft, this country is holding together. And so I want to say to young people, this is a wonderful country. It still offers so many more opportunities. It's our job as your elders to help you to see those opportunities and to help you to navigate those opportunities. That is our job as older people. And we must do it, and I'm not doing it well enough. But I want to say to young people, you must have courage to dream and to put fire under the backsides of those who should know of better and who should be helping you. So please
remain activists, be activists, it's your right.
Thank you so much, Cheryl. The last question is, you didn't want your resume to be read, but I saw something quite sneaky that was put into your introduction. Can you tell us what makes you tick? And I've seen the hand gliding and the dancing and the cooking. Can you give us a little bit of what makes Cheryl Carolus tick? What makes you get up in the morning? Because every now and then with load shedding and all of our challenges, it feels like it's becoming more difficult. But as you say, we have a fabulous country. But what makes you tick?
That's a very sneaky question. No, you know, it's actually something I learned very early in my life. I made a lifestyle choice that I wanted to be happy. Very simple. That's what I want for myself. And then I said to myself, okay, you're clearly not happy. At the age of 13, I joined my first political organization. And there's something very wrong when a 13-year-old child actually joined an organization. I was not alone. Every youth in this country was hopping mad. And I said to myself, okay, so you don't like what you see and what you're being subjected to, where two biological facts that you had no control over. Firstly, the sex with which you were born, and that is I happen to be a girl child, and the color of my skin, which happened to be black. Those two things were used as justification to exclude me from what my society had to offer. So I was very, very unhappy. So I said to myself, okay, so what are you going to do? And I joined a political organization. And that's still throughout my life, whether it is for, like now, you may know that I have stepped away very consciously. I don't hold any political leadership in our country. I have no desire to do that. It's a very important job that those who do hold leadership, whether it's in their parties, whether it's in our governments, local, provincial, wherever, they must take that very seriously, and we must respect those offices and positions, but they must earn it. But whenever I am unhappy, and there's a lot that makes us unhappy, from Eskom, I mean, we were without water the other day, and I get up in my head because I think I'm entitled to expect better. So when I say I'm unhappy about this, and I say to myself, what am I going to do? And I'm out there mobilizing. As I know many of you are, you in some of the structures with me mobilizing to hold my organization, the ANC, accountable, and everybody else. And we work with good people in other political parties to get the change we want to see. So for me, make a lifestyle decision that you're going to be happy. So the other thing for me is I love my garden. I love nature. I love planting strawberries and tomatoes, and I'm shocked. I've now got a nachi growing. My first little nachi is now coming up in my yard, and it makes me very happy. I love my country. I just drove from Cape Town through the Swartberg Pass, through the Poitiersberg Pass, through Prince Alfred Pass. And I just gave thanks for this beautiful country. I want to protect nature. And I want to make sure that this beauty that we have is kept. So, my program director, I think it's a very simple thing. What makes me tick is my determination to be happy. And I will not let other people try to steal my happiness. And if they do, oh, I come back like they did in jail over the many years, and many of us have, and many of you still are. So make your own happiness. Don't let people stand between you and your happiness. You have it in your hands, and it's not going to be easy. It will come at a price sometimes, but do it. It's worth it.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much, Cheryl. We're going to show the video of you now. So thanks for that. But let's give Cheryl a hand of applause as she goes back and we pull up the video. Thank you.
Stories we could tell, the teacher who helped us to count,
fly.
Excellent. Thanks for that, Cheryl. And of course, yesterday was the Global National Teachers Day. So I hope all of you did get to send that special message of thanks to that special teacher in your lives. So now, today, James, this is our session. And in a long while, we're not going to fight about cash flow or any kind of difficult things. We're just going to have a little bit of fun. And we're going to use Ashley's cheese. So so what we're going to do is we're going to, you've heard quite a bit of the history of JET. We're going to pull up a few numbers. So if you see the screens, we're just going to a little bit of context in it. I'm going to have a bit of a conversation with James to add some context to this. And Cleo, wherever you are, just look at your cell phone, please. Right. So, James, in terms of the start of JET in the early years, what's significant about the 500,000 that started the journey of JET? And Cheryl actually gave context to much more that was there. So I think Rory will have to investigate part of that. But maybe you can take us through what that meant in terms of then and in terms of how it propelled Jet off to where it is today.
Good afternoon to everybody. I think my one takeaway, just as I start today, is probably to let go of some things as well, Cheryl. Now, I'm listening to the video and to what you said. And the sound in this venue is a disaster, okay? And the kids are making a lot of noise. But you know, there's something about Jet that accommodates this kind of thing, and it's okay not to be perfect. I see even, I hope I mustn't bring your attention to this note, Jet, but the one banner has got a spelling mistake on, guys. Really. I think actually it's a combination of evolution and evaluation, isn't that right? M&E team. But you know, I'm sitting here and I'm realizing there's something about Jet that makes Jet work. If you look at the banner on the right-hand side, at least it hasn't got a typo on, okay? So it's okay. But you know, this is just something about how our team at Jet works. People get on with stuff in that team. They get on with stuff and they make a difference. It's not always perfect. You know, when we came here, Kelly, I see sitting in the back there, and Kelly said, so what are we eating today? Is it Jet food or are we outsourcing it? And she said, I don't want to eat Jet food. You know, let's get the specialists. And I think today I'm just a little bit like, it's okay, guys. It's okay even for this event not to be perfect. But there's something about Jet that's important. So what Matthew and I are going to do just in 10 or 15 minutes, instead of a long speech, we're going to take you through a couple of numbers, and you need to help us. So the first number, it's actually got three extra zeros, Natalie, by the way. Okay. So 500 million was the number that was brought together to set up Jet. But this is still an important number. We're currently working with Anglo-American that has just finished funding education interventions around their mines, Sean, for 500 million. Anglo-American has just renewed that grant with another 510 million. So 500 million is an important number for education in this country. And Jet has always played an important role when it comes to these numbers. So Natalie, the next thing is around partnerships. So if we can have the next slide. 26 is an important number. Do you want to talk to it?
Yes, so that's quite significant because the start of Jet, of course, came with a good amount of money. James just added three zeros to it. So I think in today's terms, James, that would be basically 1.5, 1.7 billion in terms of what Jet started off at that point. But of course, in terms of longevity, you go further when you go together, as the saying goes. So 26 was basically the first couple of years when Jet started off with. And if you look at where we're at now, and maybe they can pull up that slide, odds were from the early years, you would see that we're still working with a good number of those partners. Some of them have morphed into something different, something more. But in terms of the consistency of who we associate with, I think that's been critical. You've mentioned Anglo, for instance. Anglo was one of the starting partners, but we also work with Sanlam and the Sanlam Foundation, for instance. We work with First Rand, and in terms of the philanthropists that we also work with, those are family foundations who do not go out and look and do tenders and whatsoever. They come to you when there's a level of trust that they want to invest in. So that's quite significant.
So the next number that's important to us is three. So if the person using the slides can just work with us. Internationally, Jet is affiliated with three international organizations at the moment. UNESCO, UNIVOC. This is a vocational network of centers across the world, and Jet has been a center for quite a few years. Anthony, who's in the audience, I didn't see Bina. Anthony, if you can just wave. Where are you? So Anthony and Bina, while they were at Jet, set up this partnership. And it has been so good for Jet over the last, at least the last 8 to 10 years. So appreciation for that, Anthony. We're also part of the Groningen Declaration Network. Now, if you don't speak Afrikaans, I had a call today with somebody in India and she couldn't get the Groningen. Okay? The Groningen Declaration Network, or GDN, is an international network of credential evaluators. And guess what? We've got a team there next week in the Netherlands that is doing a whole panel session on the work that Jet is doing with Mercita. Really significant piece of work. The other example I want to give you is around AI in education. Jet is part of the EdSafe AI Alliance. This is an international startup that is trying to look at ethics in the use of AI in education. So we're punching well below, not below, well above our weight. We must get our numbers right today, well above our weight in terms of education. Right, the next number, please. So the next number is 2,000. Do you want to talk to it?
Yeah, so in the year 2000, and maybe it was well timed, I must ask Nick if it had anything to do with the change of the century, but JET became an NPO, a non-profit organization. So it meant a shift. Now, in terms of being cash flushed, and that was my previous life, James, and every now and then I have to remind James that at Treasury, I was the money lady, and now I have to go and ask for money. And it's not an easy ask, Cheryl, it's not. But it also means we need to work extremely hard for our worth. And Cheryl, we actually haven't lost our edge in terms of the social dimension around having to do pro bono, additional support. Just last night, Tapiwa and I, Tapiwa is a program manager for Anglo. We had a bit of a tug war around a massive resourced Anglo program. Do we have a school included? Because we might run out of money. Do we offer a piecemeal service just to make sure that we can please the client? Or do we go gung ho and we still provide a full suite of resources? And those are challenges that we face every day. Of course, we included the school. But the point is, on to date, there's been about 384 new proposals that's been developed. And that means a tremendous amount of thinking, budgeting, planning, resourcing. That is that. Do you think we're doing okay, James?
So over the last 6 years, JET has submitted 384 proposals for funding. I kid you not, I don't know anybody who's been involved in that process to show your hands, like most of JET's staff. 384. So JET is not an organization that is just sitting back and receiving funding. We have to work really hard for the funding that we receive. It's about 60 a year that we do. So I think we'll go to the next slide, and I'll quickly talk about this. So infinity is also important to us. So our current strategy helps position us around many of the things that we're talking to you about today. But most critically, if I can just use this one example, when you recruit for staff, you recruit for two characteristics, and I always ask the HR team to tell me what they are, not for me to tell them. But maybe I won't put them on the spot now. So firstly, we recruit for somebody, Thamma, I hope you know, for an activist. So we want somebody who's got an activist orientation. But it doesn't help you only an activist, and you can't do research and you can't work in education. So we always look at these two characteristics. Are you an activist at heart and a researcher and maybe more intellectual academic at mind? Those are the people we appoint. And what I'll show you now in terms of the slide you see there, these are the three areas that the people work in. Strong research, strong implementation, and strong monitoring and evaluation spelled correctly. Okay? So this is the three areas that we're working, and our teams are well positioned in these three areas. So if you can go to the next slide, just briefly. Okay, imagine.
Before James wants to jump over the infinity and beyond. So I started in June 2020, okay? And before that, James said, okay, you're gonna walk straight into the new strategy development. Fine, I've done a few strategies in my career. We started off and we decided it's going to be a participatory process. So all staff are involved, all hands on deck. It's interesting, it's good. And then James invited Rios Partners, one of our strategic partners, to say, let's see how they help us think through these issues in an objective manner. So I'm used to, you get consultants on board and they do the work and they actually report to you. So we're sitting in one meeting and I'm like, I haven't received your project plan. I haven't received your methodology. And James jumps out and says, no, wait. We're going to do it together. So afterwards I asked James, if we're going to make this in 13 and beyond produced to the board in time, I need to know the parameters of how JET people work, okay? Because it was difficult for me to get into, you get consultants on board, but you do the work. So it's a different ball game. And in terms of infinity and beyond, I think what that means for the organization is we continue to work in different ways. We continuously ask our staff to do slightly different things. They're still familiar, but to constantly stretch the target, to constantly stretch the conversation and the dialogue. So thanks for that as well, James.
So the next one is quite important. I'm just waiting for it to come up. So we didn't put a number on one. Okay, it is important not to use a number. But I think what is important, we looked at who is our youngest staff member, JET, and who is the most mature. And you know, I'm just giving a lot of credit to Nick today, but Nick is still with us. Nick still mentors young researchers. Nick is still very involved in education. So Nick, you're my role model, and it's an appreciation from all of us for what you're doing.
So I'm doing the tumamina to Nick. I want to ask Nick, with your illustrious career, Nick, can you tell us about how many publications, books, reviews you've done? Just maybe set infinity sign.
I don't really know, Natalie, but you know, I've always written because writing enables you to organize your thoughts, put them down properly. You've got a permanent trace of what you're thinking. You can amend it, you can restructure it, but your thoughts are down there. So I started writing when I was a teacher. I wrote maths textbooks, which started off as lesson plans and then gradually expanded and eventually we had textbooks. So I wrote textbooks for the whole school right from grade 1 up to grade, what do we got now, 12. And then when I came to JET, I started doing the same thing, organizing my thoughts about where we're going, what are we doing, why is our schooling so poor, what do we need to do with our teachers, and so it grew from there. And it's self-expression, but it's also trying to order your thoughts into a coherent pattern. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nick. Thanks for that. So the other number that will come up just now is number 19. And we have 3 learnerships. And those are the youngest people of the JET team. I'm going to read the names. And if you're here, just put up your hand so that we can see you. It's Botshelo Goodwill Khaje, Ompile Mahwani, Petolo Mokonyani. So those are our 3 19-year-olds that are part of the JET team. So lend a hand, all JET setters.
The next number is 40. I don't know, we should start asking people what the numbers are for. It seems like an auction. 40 is the average age of our staff across the organization. So that's interesting. You know, I would like to be below 30, and I think that's a good age. But if you look at the maturity and the work that we do, 40 is probably not too bad. So it's the average age across our organization. So I'm not going to ask people who's over 40 to put up their hands, eh? The next number, and we just have to watch our time, Natalie. So this is a 2. This is our number of our internationally based staff. We've got 2 staff members that are not based in South Africa. Kelly is sitting at the back there. Kelly, just like wave. Kelly's based in Japan, or in the US, or in South Africa. So between one of the 3 countries. We've also got a colleague in the Netherlands. So Carla Pereira, who used to be our COO, is now based in the Netherlands. Now with remote working, these things are working so well for us. So it helps us also to work into Africa from that side of the world. The next one, Natalie, do you want to talk to this one?
The jet streamers?
Yeah, jet streamers actually started just before COVID, and James in 2019. So JET had the courage and the partnership to start off with an internship program. And it wasn't your everyday internship program that you go and make photocopies and you want phones and you take the dry cleaning for James. No. People actually had to come in, do actual work, and they had the opportunity to work with fantastic mentors such as Nick, such as Andrew, Monica, Eleanor, Kelly, but the spread of the cream of JET. And what was excellent about the program is we onboarded 10. We know of all 10 of them being in permanent or in jobs, and we've retained 3 of them, and I'm going to quickly ask them to get up. Patrick, Lesedi, and Morris.
So the next number is a number 2, so we're getting on with it now, guys. If it's getting boring, we're nearly there. 2 is our level of accreditation with investors and people. So when we recruit, we look at activists and researchers, but we also look at culture. There's this finding saying that culture eats strategy for breakfast. So we recruit for culture, and we ask an external auditor what our culture is like. We don't tell ourselves. So this is a UK accreditation that we've got a level 2 or a silver in, which I think is important. You know, it's just to show that we are serious about this. Okay, the next one. Shall I just quickly do this one? You okay? So 20, I think, is important. We're 20 years old as an PBO or an NPR. But where's Rory? Oh, there's Rory. We also have 20 unqualified audits. Since JET was established as an NPO, we have had unqualified audits. Now, those of you that are not in the financial, unqualified is good, eh? And qualified is not good. Just make sure we get that right. Sometimes people switch it around. This is really important for us in terms of our work with international funders. And it's hard work, I promise you. And CFOs like Rory has joined us recently play an important role. Okay, the next one quickly, and I'll give back to you now. Natalie is 16. This has got to do with our chairperson. I don't know if he knows that. All right. So our chairperson, Nathan Johnston, who you met a bit earlier, has been with JET for 16 years. I think that's pretty serious. And Nathan, appreciation from us as a staff and the management team. The next number is a number 9. We have 9 board members, which are really important. We've got the majority of them here. Am I allowed to like ask you guys just to stand up or wave your hands? Zaina, you don't look excited. Maud, Angie, Adrian. Anybody else I'm missing? Thank you for what you do. Bongani, at the back there, thank you. Good to see you, thank you. All right, the next number, let me just quickly put this down. And I'm taking over now, Natalie, you can push back. 108? Are we still okay on time? Okay. 108 is the cumulative number of years our board members have served the JET. So I'm not saying you're old, I'm saying you've been with JET for a long time. Okay, just go one slide back, please. 108 years. I think that's significant for an organization like JET, 108 years. Okay, the next one is also linked to our board. So I'm sure many of you would know Brian Fagaji. Brian Fagaji is well known in the education sector. Brian is retiring this year after 22 years on the JET board. So now that credibility and authenticity that JET has been with us for a long time. Okay, the next one. 5.1 is a number that's quite important to me. So this is the average number of years our core staff have studied after matric. So when I look at our staff, many of you are here today, the average amongst us is 5 years. That means most of you have at least a postgraduate qualification. It also shows us how difficult it is to get into the entry into the market nowadays. You know, you've got to have a postgrad to get into the market, and at JET it's 5.1 years. All right, the next one is one, and then I'll get back to you, Natalie. We've got one new board member joining us. So Prof. Chika Sahuli, who is the Dean of Education at University of Pretoria, will be joining JET from 2023 as a board member. And we're very excited to have Chika on board. Chika used to work at JET a long time ago. We always say a JET, once a JET setter, always a JET setter. So we went to fetch him where he is Dean, and he will now, in effect, replace Brian Fugaji as a board member, and we're very excited about that. All right, the next one, please. 36, do you want to talk about this one? Do you want me to keep going?
I don't even know what
it is. Okay, we lost it. Okay. Okay, let me quickly finish this. So at any point, JET manages 36 projects. Just in case any staff member or anybody from the outside is with us today, just wants to think about the workload that our team carries. We carry about 36 different initiatives at any point. The next slide, please. We've had three CEOs over 30 years. Okay? I think that's quite significant. To have CEOs that have stayed and even still with us. And Godwin's not with us, he's in the UK at the moment, but Godwin still works very closely with us around the work that we do. All right, I think that's about it. I think there's a last one, perhaps. I think that's it. So if you can just, if I can maybe just summarize, Natalie. I didn't ask you anything, eh?
No.
Yeah, okay. I think thank you for being with us today, and we've tried to do an annual meeting in a slightly different way. Not with long, too many long speeches. I don't classify what you did as a speech, just by the way. I think it's inspiring, and I'm just like, I think we're in a good place as an organization. NGOs and education that are 30 years old are few and far between. JET is serious about what it's doing, and there's definitely another 30 years ahead, Natalie. So thank you also for your support and for being with JET. Natalie soon learned that the Treasury hat had to be replaced with an NGO hat, and she's done fantastic. So thank you for that as well.
Thank you. James, just look up at the screen. This is a thank you to you. I think from the staff's side, James, and from the board, thank you. This hasn't been an easy couple of years, but you made it better. And thanks for JET's staff. Thanks for lifting James up. Thanks for giving courage. Thanks for bringing innovation. And thanks for bringing your diverse self. Because it is what we can do because of
the. So a big shout out to James. Thanks. Right. So thanks. Our next item is about our youth. Oh no, it's about Yui first. Purple U is going to sing for us. Thanks.
Need a needed of your sight. So reflect, not regret all the things that we have in this life. We're talking about these streets that we live upon, these streets that we walk upon, these streets that we live upon, these streets that we walk, forgive us life, forgive us life. They give us life. They give us life. Black and white, all so bright. All I see is you see. Smiles and frowns all around between you and me. Now I'm so convinced that we have this life goal. How we hold it and mold it determines how it will grow. These streets that we live upon, these streets that we walk upon, these streets that we live upon, these streets that we walk, they give us life. They give us life. They give us life. They give us. You gotta help us sing this song. Very simple. La la a la ta la. La la a la ta la. La la a la ta la. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Purple You. Thank you for that. Okay, so we have two learners, and they are from the Eldorain High School. So we wanted to hear a little bit of the young voices, our main clients. So two of them are going to speak to us about what would happen if they were a president for a day. So I'm going to call up Tony and Elnery, maybe you want to come and sit here upstairs as well. Shalom. Tony is, Abrams is 17 years old. She is in grade 12, both of them actually. And she would, when she was asked for a bit of, to say something about herself, she just said she would be described as passionate. Right? Next year, she will be studying towards a law degree. And a favorite quote is, nothing is impossible and everything is possible for those who believe. So, an inspiring president already. Over to you, Rory. Tony. No. You're doing it together? No. Oh, lovely. Okay. Two presidents coming up. So, Elnery, she's also in grade 12 and 17 years old. She would describe herself as independent, okay? And her mom is a role model, also independent, and that is how she was raised. She sees herself as hardworking and to strive to be the best in what she does. She wants to be a chef and a writer, okay? So she will not be studying next year, but she will work at this at the clinic hub. I have issues with gap years, so we'll have a conversation afterwards. I'll have to check in with you. And she's also planning on publishing her own book next year, so there's a little bit of work factored in the gap year. So we'll speak in a year's time. So over to the two ladies, give them a hand of applause. Thanks.
Can you hear me? There we go. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. So, if I was president for a day, I would reinforce the prisons, the South African prisons. I would give them new life, new possibility. So, the reason why I say this is I recently watched on Netflix the world's toughest prisons, and there's a prison called Nkosa Central Prison, and this prison once had a reputation for one of the most violent and dangerous prisons in the world. And this, this caused there to be about 6 suicides in less than 10 months every year. Now I know they're criminals, but they're still people. So six suicides in less than 10 months, that's insane. But after Anna Alistair Lewis took over in 2014, she changed everything about that prison with one idea and one word: human and humanely. Since the reinforcement, the prison's reoffending rate dropped to 15%, where it was previously over 50%. There's also no drugs or drug dealing in the prisons, unlike most prisons where that is the most common thing you can find. So the thing why this is so close to my heart is I did my research one day and I found that South African prisons do not provide any rehabilitation for their prisoners. And we have a reoffending rate of between 55 and 95%. Just for a minute, imagine that. A reoffending rate of 95%. How can we live in a safe country, in a safe environment, if our reoffending rate is that high? That is absolutely unbelievable. And I think we all want a safe South Africa at this point. So I believe that we need to reinforce prisons by allowing prisoners to live in humane circumstances, because living in inhumane circumstances literally crushes your mindset into this negative atmosphere where you don't want to change and you don't want to do good and you don't change your ways. And I believe that humane circumstances can allow these prisoners to be more positive and realize that, well, life isn't all bad and I have a chance in this world. I also believe that we need to provide more resources in our prisons. Libraries where they can study, computers where they can complete college and university courses, because what is a person without a way in their life? What is a person when they don't know what they want to be or want to do? So giving them that opportunity to be like, wait, I can be a good lawyer. I'm actually good at math. Why would someone that has something to believe in want to do that? And then I want to end with a quote before I'm going to get over to my very accomplished associate. Maria Abu-Jamal, an inmate, said the following: prison is a second-by-second assault on the soul, a day-by-day degradation of the self, an oppressive steel and brick umbrella that transforms seconds into hours and hours into days. So now I ask you, how are we supposed to decrease the offending and reoffending rates when criminals are not given the chance to change their mindset and way of life?
Afternoon. Can you guys hear me? Cool. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Tony Abrams. So I was asked, if I was president for a day, what would I do? And I would enforce employment. So here's why. As many of you know, job unemployment in South Africa is some of the, it's like it's a trouble that many South Africans face daily. Stats SA reported that there was a 4.34% increase of job unemployment from since 2020 to 2022. And South Africa also has one of the highest rates of unemployment in the world. So this is why I feel that we need to enforce employment. The impact of high unemployment, amongst others, is that high unemployment leads to high levels of desperation, and high levels of desperation results in people who are unemployed and have no source of income. They will inevitably alert to crime to get what they need to satisfy their basic needs. So this is resulting in high crime. Secondly, it also places a burden on the taxpayers, and so those who are unemployed would have to contribute more to the state office in order to provide social welfare programs for the unemployed. Then many of you are asking now, Tony, how are you going to enforce unemployment? This is how I'm gonna do it. So job creation can be brought about in the following way, and specifically in today's context. Two public works projects that can contribute to the fourth industrial revolution, investing in digital technologies, for example. If you use the Roosevelt example as a laying down as the New Deal, where they were digging trenches. In case of trenches, we can use fiber, we can lay down fiber networks specifically in areas that don't have broadband or internet connectivity at all. This would help not only in reducing unemployment, but also contribute to its economic development. Job creation can also take place by investing in transport, energy, and information and communications technologies, which would promote economic activity and job creation through a variety of channels. So, conclusion, the enforcement of employment does not only provide people with jobs, but the crowding effect it has is enormous. And employment might sound like it may only solve one problem, but really it encourages economic activity and productivity, leading to deflation, causing people to have more buying power, which increases demand, and this leads to economic growth and development. This is exactly why I would enforce employment if I was president for a day. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, and all of the best to you and for the final exams. And we're looking forward to checking in with you in the near future. Thank you so much. Thank you. I think we have another music item. Purple, you're back on stage.
For one of our greatest performers, musicians in this country, can play the music? Thank you, DJ Floyd. Nice bow, come on.
I'm gonna pray now. All my love, wanna burn out. All my love, wanna burn out. All my love.
I'm gonna come on the street, so I'm gonna try to go now. Are you sure?
I get, are you sure? The ladies and the gents and the staff here. Yeah, that's right. I need to know I love my heart. It can be hard enough. Let me tell you one more time.
Come on! How's everybody doing this time?
I'm gonna burn out. Oh my Lord, I'm gonna burn.
Who put this in so far?
I'm gonna burn out. Oh my Lord.
Are you sure? Are you good, man? Are you good this side? It's almost the weekend.
Ready for your weekend, I think.
Thank you, Purple. Thanks for keeping the energy going. So we've reached the end of our structured program. I'm going to ask Adrian to come up and to do a vote of thanks. As Adrian comes up, Adrian is our director of our board, and she's also the chair of our finance and audit committee. And quite recently, she was almost employed by JIT. So.
Good morning, good afternoon. In typical JIT efficiency, I've been given a cheat sheet. So I know that I can say what I should be saying. And I think we're starting at the right place. That's JIT management and staff. I've never seen a company with such a small staff that achieves what it's currently achieving. It's really quite amazing. They are supported by the JIT board, and everyone on that board wants to be there. It's not just because they've been asked, they actually want to be there, and I think that's an added value to the company. All our partners, and there are many. James has given you a whole list of how many and what they are, and we keep them. We don't have a partner for a week or two and move on to the next one. They come back and we come back. Today's a very important 30th anniversary. We have many people that have added value to the 30 years of JIT history, and we need to thank all of them, whether they were the kids behind the desks or they were people at the universities and our staff. Cheryl, thank you very much for making time in your busy life to come and give us our keynote address. We appreciate it. The TVs, we couldn't do it. We want a record of this day, so thank you, Palmer TV. Fawn Studiski, also, thank you so much. Leith Creatives, Huey Lowe, the artist from Purple Hue, Gusankula Primary School in Soweto. We've got so many people to thank. Tony Abrams and Alnira Heller from Eldorain High School, Emmy Pioneering Tents and Decor, food, glorious food, which you're going to enjoy soon, hashtag promotions, the Cake Zone. Well, we haven't tasted it yet, but we've certainly seen it. It's amazing. The Sarbona Discovery Center, their team, thank you very much. It's a lovely venue for our particular company. We work in the educational space, which hearing the kids, that's our target market. So they're right here. Last but no means least, all JET staff members, present and otherwise. Without you, JET would not be what it is and where it is today. And we thank all of you for carrying the JET flag for 30 years. It's quite a time to celebrate. Thanks very much, and may education in Africa grow in leaps and bounds so that we become one of those well-known countries for good education for all our people. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much, Adrian. Thanks for that. So I'm going to call, we have the full Monty here. You can see this beautiful cake. And I think it's inspired by Tato. Tato, thank you for this. I'm going to ask Kathy and Morris. They're not getting married, don't worry. But I'm going to ask them to come forward. And while Kathy and Morris come forward to do the cutting of the cake, it's going to be something symbolic. Then you will have the waiters filling up your glasses, and we're going to have a toast for that. Okay. Do you want to stand other on that side? Oh, good. I think this is more photo moment. Yeah. So this is a complicated cake. Do we cut from the top or from the bottom?
Okay, in we go.
And just to mention, Kathy's been with JET for 30 years. Yes. Thank you. Auntie Kathy. Thank you.
I hope you're going to enjoy your food. Okay, and that you will have a slice of the cake, and please enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Morris. Morris is one of our young and upcoming managers. He's doing his internship this year. So, anything from your side, Morris?
Thanks to JET for giving me an opportunity. And yeah, I've grown a lot since I joined JET, and there's been a massive improvement, and I'm glad that I'm part of this organization. And as Kathy said, that yeah, it's like we are married to JET again. So yeah, I'm happy to be part of this organization, and yeah, enjoy the cake.
Thank you. So do you all have your glasses filled except for the two green ladies in the front? You have the juice with you. Please get your glasses filled.
And Maureen, do you want to come forward? Want to do it here?
So good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you all have your glasses charged. My association with JET goes back to 1996. In 2003, I was in the fortunate position of having to choose between joining JET full-time or another organization. I made the prescient choice to join JET, and well, it's 2022 and I'm still here. So today I have the honor to ask you to rise and join me in a toast to JET. To the people whose vision led to its founding in 1992, and to the many dedicated and hardworking people, as well as to the organizations who have contributed to sustaining and growing JET over the past 30 years. Here's to the next 30.
Thank you. And on that note, our formal agenda has ended. And I just want to invite you now to join us for lunch, have some drinks. I think Purple U is going to remain here to do some music. So the dancing has started. And thanks for spending the morning and the afternoon with us. God bless. Thank you. I'm
I'll see you, guys.